Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us today for the School on Wheels workshop, Introduction to Group Tutoring and the Digital Learning Model. I'm here with Chris Ruoff, who is joining us. He is a tutor coordinator and tutor. He's been with us for a year. And I am the engagement specialist at School on Wheels. I have been here about 3 years now, and I do volunteer support and training and partnerships at School on Wheels. So I will be just assisting Chris as he gives his presentation. Just a note before we get started, for the quality of sound, we recommend you using a headset, and all participants are currently muted. If you need to ask a question, you can type it in at any time using the question pane on the right-hand side of your screen, and we will be pausing at a couple points in the presentation to look at questions and also at the end. So be sure to type in your question whenever you have one, and we want to hear your feedback. If you're a tutor at a group, if you're at a tutor in a group situation, we would love to hear how your experience has been. So I'm going to turn it over to Chris and let him introduce himself.
Oh, well, thank you, Amanda, and good day, everyone. Thanks for making it to our webcast today. As Amanda mentioned, I've been a tutor and tutor coordinator about for the last year. So I'm coming up on my one-year anniversary with School on Wheels, and it's just been a wonderful experience for me. And I have been focused exclusively in group tutoring environments. So I am here today to share with you my experiences, and whether you're already tutoring in a group environment or you're considering this, and we sure hope you will, this workshop is for you. So I've, starting in order here, I have volunteered at the Santa Ana Armory, which is an emergency shelter, the homemade shelter in Orange, which just opened a couple months ago. That's a temporary shelter. And my big focus recently has been Washington Elementary and the after-school program there. And I'll talk about all of those. I also want to mention that also listening on the line with us today is Lillian, who is our senior regional coordinator for South Orange County. And we've been working together for the last year, and it's just been a fabulous experience. So I just want to thank Lillian and Amanda for all their wonderful support. Okay, so what are we going to talk about today? First, I'm going to go into the shelters, types of shelters, the operation, and specifically the tutoring environment, what you'll be walking into, communication in those shelters and environments, best practices, and really how to be prepared. I'm going to share with you everything I've learned over the last year, and I hope this really helps you have a fabulous experience wherever you do your group tutoring. I'll talk about school locations, so what we're doing with our after-school program, again, the tutoring environment there, what to expect, and really how to be prepared. Next, I'll talk about the School on Wheels digital learning model, and right now that's the Khan Academy and Teacher Monster to Read applications, and how they can supplement what you're doing as tutors. These are wonderful applications that really help take our tutoring to the next level. I'll also talk about additional tools and resources for any group environment. And as Amanda mentioned, we want your questions. So we'll take those. And again, as you think of something, please type it in and send it in for us. All right, let's get into the first type of shelter that I was a part of back in October of last year. This is an emergency, what are called emergency shelters, or you might hear them referred to as cold weather shelters. But you can actually see, if you look at the photo, this is what it looks like inside. This is the Santa Ana Armory, and it's a live training center during the day. And miraculously at night, it's reconfigured as a shelter. And you can see all the black mats on the floor. Those are where the families come in and bed down for the night. And so this transforms into a shelter for nighttime use. This one was operated by the Mercy House staff. Mercy House is a partner of School on Wheels. And so they actually staffed and facilitated this particular shelter. And we came in and did the tutoring. And the way this works is the families check in about 6 o'clock p.m., more or less. They'd get set up, eat their meals, get showered, and get, you know, get ready for the night for curfew. As you can imagine, if you look at the building, you can imagine a bunch of kids running around playing, parents distracted. You know, they're trying to get their situation under control. So it can be a these types of shelters can be very noisy and very distracting. So keep that in mind. We did have temporary tables set up for tutoring. We didn't know if they were going to be in the very front of the room towards the doors, as you can see, or they might be in the back of the armory where the picture was taken, next to the really cold doors, or I should say the big doors that would open up, so it would be very cold back there. We started our tutoring at around 7, 2 nights a week for an hour. And we had about 4 to 5 tutors each night, tutoring students of all grades, K through 12. And you know, something really important here. Our tutoring was one of the constants in their lives. They looked forward to seeing us there. They really counted on us being there. You know, in a very hectic day that they must have been going through, they knew we would be there for tutoring, and they really looked forward to us. We would have kids literally standing at those doors that you see on the end, waiting for us to come in. And so they knew they could count on us. So that's the kind of environment you might be walking into at an emergency shelter. So let me now share with you some of the challenges that you'll face and some tips. So as I mentioned, because there were a lot of moving pieces here, this was a live base during the day and a shelter at night, we wouldn't always get the same tutoring location. And School on Wheels provides a backpack of supplies to all of our locations, but we wouldn't always get that on time. You know, it might be part of the move and that maybe it was missing and or maybe it's in a truck somewhere on its way. So a couple things here in terms of the temperature variations, especially during the winter, bring a light jacket or even a sweatshirt with you because you don't know where the tutoring tables might be. It might be in the front where it's warmer, might be in the back where the big metal doors are rolled up. And during warmer weather, like in the summertime, you know, just dress appropriately. No shorts, no cutoffs, tank tops. Remember, we're tutoring young students, so we have to dress appropriately. And bring a water bottle with you. That's always a key thing to have. And I can't stress this enough about having your own small backpack. You don't know whether you may not have supplies, or maybe your student needs a supply and you'll have one for them. So I would strongly recommend making your own little backpack up. And by the way, the kids love this because they think it's cool that us tutors have backpacks like they do. Makes us look like one of them, right? Or they can really relate to us. But inside your backpack, put pencils, sharpeners, crayons, colored pencils, paper, grade level worksheets, all that kind of stuff. But it's always good to have your own backpack. All right, so I talked about the big open space and the noise and distractions. And it's really hard to keep the students focused on their work. They want to be out running around playing games, or they want to be with maybe some kids they just met, right? That just checked into the shelter. But one of the tips that I have, this has worked really well. Let them know that, hey, we'll play a game after we're done with your homework. Hangman was really popular at this particular place, but it gives the kids some incentive to get their homework done, and then they know there's a little bit of time afterwards to have some fun, and they get used to that. Another good tip is, you know, walk around and introduce yourself. Invite the parents over to the tutoring tables. Most, if not all of them, are very supportive of what we're doing. You get to know them, and they will start telling you little things about their children that, you know, maybe they're struggling in one area, or maybe they're trying to work with them in a particular on a particular subject. So the more you get to know the parents, the more supportive they are, and that really pays off for us as tutors. Another big challenge, hey, this is a shelter. You just don't know who's going to show up. So first of all, you know, don't expect the same students every week. It's a really good thing if they're not there because perhaps they've found a more stable place to live. So that's a good situation for the families. But for us as tutors, you know, we do get attached to some of these kids, and you might be working with somebody on times tables and you get to the fives week and they don't show up. So that's just the nature of the business for us as tutors, unfortunately. But another tip is to, and there are a lot of these, late arrivals. You know, they don't always get there at 6 o'clock or whenever check-in time is. So invite them to bring their meal to the table and they can tutor while eating. My opinion is more, or I would say any tutoring is better than no tutoring. So, you know, have them bring their meal over to the table. We can get things done while they're eating. And so another tip is, you know, because of the transient nature here, we ask tutors to help keep track of attendance so that we know who's showing up. And plus, you want to be able to log your hours and you have to list the students that you worked with. So good tip here, take a photo of the attendance sheet and text it to your TC. As a group, just make sure somebody's taking a photo of the attendance sheet and texting it to your tutor coordinator. And then finally, again, we're going to get kids from K to 12. One of the really good things to do here is talk amongst the tutors and find out what y'all like to do. I'm the math guy, and so I get a lot of the math students. We had a couple math people, but we had a teacher that loved reading and grammar, another that loved science. So if you know or understand each other's capabilities and likes, that helps the tutoring go a long, long way. So split up the way you like to. All right, so this would be a really good point. Amanda, do we have any questions at this point on this?
No questions so far. Feel free to, the audience, please type them in if you have them. We can go on, Chris.
Cool, thanks. Okay, now we're gonna shift gears and talk about another type of shelter. This is a more temporary shelter. It's not an emergency shelter. These are designed as shelters and they may even operate year round. So the one I'm using as an example is where I'm actually helping out now. It's the new homemade shelter in Orange. This again is operated by Mercy House. In fact, some of the staff that was at the Armory shifted over here. So it's good to know them. This particular shelter opens at 5. Families check in at that time, eat their meal, get showered. Here, there's a permanent area for tutoring, which is really nice. So we know exactly where we're going to go night to night. Some of these shelters may even have computers. In fact, Homemade has 4. So we can apply the digital learning model here and use that. We are there 3 nights a week for an hour each night, Tuesday, Friday, and Sunday. And we have anywhere from 3 to 4 tutors each night. And again, we get students of all grades, K through 12, and again, you don't know who's coming in, so you have to be ready for just about any type of student, any grade. The nice thing about this particular shelter is it is a more stable, because it's a temporary shelter and not an emergency shelter, it's more stable. It's quieter, easy to focus there, but still some of the same challenges. You know, kids like to run around and play games, and so you have to deal with that. And again, being a transient population, you're not going to get the same students every week. But again, this is another type of shelter that you may be asked to tutor in. And so you'll see that. All right, let's move on to group tutoring in a school environment. So in May of this year, we opened an after-school tutoring program at Washington Elementary in Santa Ana, and we have about 25 students and 8 tutors. In fact, we even ran this program through the summer and had a great turnout and participation from kids that wanted to be a part of this in the summertime. We do our tutoring after school on Mondays and Wednesdays for 1 hour, and we do it in the computer lab. And there are 30 computers there and tables for homework. We provide free Khan Academy and Teacher Monster accounts to each one of these students. And there's one login and one password for both. So they only have to know their login ID and a very simple password, and they can access both of these accounts. And by the way, they can access these accounts outside of school hours, wherever they have or whenever they have access to a computer. Now, we supplement their classwork by helping them finish their homework and then use the online resources for digital learning. This is really handy. In fact, on Monday at Washington, I had a teacher drop off one of our students, and she said to me, she said, Johnny is not working or not getting his groupings by 10 and by 100. Do you think you can focus on that with him. So we worked on his homework first, and then we took him over and logged into Khan Academy, where we found lessons on counting by 10 and counting by 100 to supplement what he was doing in his schoolwork. So that really helps what we're doing. And I can't say enough how the support that we're getting from the administration and the teachers, and they've even said how they've noticed students improving week to week. And we have students that come in. We just had a new group come in on Monday. Some of them, honestly, don't know what they're walking into. And we've just got an amazing group of tutors that help them feel comfortable and get them going. So this is working out really, really well for us. Here's a typical tutoring day. So the students arrive right after the classes, and the great thing is our tutors are already there. And so the minute they walk into the computer lab, we're there asking them for their homework. So we sit them down at the tables, get their homework done, and when they're done with their homework, they can move on to Khan Academy and or Teacher Monster to read. If they don't have homework, we require them to fill out a grade level worksheet from the School on Wheels resources page, and I'll show you later on in the presentation where you can find all that great stuff. And here's something we created this, and it's been a really big hit, but again, it's really giving them some free time at the end. So we dedicate the last 10 minutes of the tutoring hour to free time, and they can use that to color, use the whiteboard to draw, play games, or they can stay on the computers and use other school-approved websites like ST Math, which they use at their own school. So by creating this free time, it really makes the students, they're really engaged, they want to get their work done, because they know at the end there's a bonus for them. There's a real good thing for them waiting at the end. And so it's been a big hit for us. So this is what a typical tutoring day looks like at school. And in fact, as soon as I get off this webcast, I'm heading over there for our Wednesday session. Okay, here's another good place where we can take any questions that have come up. Anything?
There's a question actually from a staff member who wants to just know, what is your experience, how was your experience becoming a TC at a school? Was the program already established before, or did you start the program?
Well, that's a great question. Lillian and I really started this program. And so as soon as I was done at Santa Ana Armory, I moved over there. And honestly, we have really created this program, and all of these key learnings have happened as a result of what we've had to do. Working with the school said, this is the first digital learning program in Orange County. We do on-site school tutoring, but nothing like this where we have the digital learning model as well. And we've really had to create this. We've had to, work with administration on this. We've had to do things like, we've had to group the students by day so that we have an even balance of students both Monday and Wednesdays. And we have, we work with the school on new students, who's coming into the program. We've established guidelines for the program, created flyers that we can send home with the parents and the kids that talk about the program. And so we've really put the whole process together, and we'd be happy to share that that process with you, because we've really had to kind of create it as we've gone. So that's how we've done this. Hopefully that answers the question.
Yeah, that does. And I think that School on Wheels is, we're trying to invest in these digital learning centers, whether they're at school, after school programs, or in other shelters. So if there are any tutors that are listening that would like to become involved and would like to be a tutor coordinator, or would like to work at one of these centers, just let us know and we can set it up with your regional coordinator. I'm sure that they would be very happy to have that interest.
Sure. And we'd be happy to share some of the documentation we've put together that we've given to the school and to the parents that talk about the program. And really, we did this to set expectations. We want students and parents and the school to know that once the students walk into the lab, here are the expectations. And we do set requirements for them to participate. For example, if they are if they're disruptive, then they get, you know, there are verbal warnings, and then that leads to a talk with the administration and the parents. And then, you know, if that doesn't improve, then unfortunately they won't be allowed to complete or to stay in the program with us. So we really need to set those expectations up front. And so that way the tutors, the administrators, the teachers, the parents, everybody's on the same page.
Absolutely. I just want to, just reinforce that group tutoring, it's so important to have those guidelines for students, that they get that buy-in early on. And so that they also, sometimes we suggest that we create the rules with the students so that they are invested in those rules. And it can just, because it can be a little bit more chaotic in a group setting. So you want to make sure that you're, you know, setting expectations, setting rules, and making sure that the students are following that.
Yeah, that's great. And right now, you know, things are going very well. We're into our, what, sixth, seventh month there now. And so things are going really well. And I think we've got this down, the great bunch of tutors, and the tutors know what they're coming into week after week. So it's a really good process that we've established, and it makes things work really well. So great question. Thank you for that one. And so here are some, you know, really some tips and best practices. What have we learned over the last six, 7 months? Well, you know, preparation is huge. So just being there when they walk in, if you're a tutor, just being there when they walk in, it makes a big difference. First of all, they're really happy to see you. You'll probably get a hug or something, or a high five or something. But they just love walking in and seeing you there. And so the first question from us as tutors is, okay, where's your homework? So I'm surprised, and you're probably not going to be surprised to hear that some students forget their homework or claim they don't have any. So a good tip here is, you know, challenge them to go get it. They just got out of class. Their teacher's probably still there. And the classroom's not too far away. So go get your homework, or share your homework from another grade level student. The nice thing about these kids, and especially in this group environment, they keep each other honest. So whether they're siblings that are tattletaling on their sibling and telling you that they, oh no, Johnny has homework, or it's somebody in class that may say, no, we have homework and here it is. So then you know, you can share that same homework with students that are in the same class. So that's a good tip for that. If they don't have homework, I mentioned that we use worksheets. So I love these worksheets. Find fun exercises for them to do, or work on times tables or other drills. We use the whiteboard a lot. So we use the whiteboard for times tables, especially math problems. You know, if the kids want to get up off from the tutoring tables and go back and use the whiteboard, they love that. You want to do it in green, red, blue, you know, it's just being able to do something, do it, but doing it a different way. And as you can see on the right here, here's an example of a worksheet I pulled off the School on Wheels resource page on a kind of a fun three times table, and they can obviously answer it and then color the crowns if they want when they're done. It's just a fun thing to do. And two very important tips: talk to the parents and talk to the teachers. You're going to get all kinds of feedback from the parents on what they perceive to be their students' needs. And you know, they love having us there to help. So get to know the parents. Again, most of them are very supportive. And talk to the teachers, if possible, to see where we can help. And again, they're extremely supportive as well. So don't be afraid to make, you know, don't be afraid to make friends with the parents and the teachers. I highly encourage it. It only makes your job as a tutor easier. All right. So if there aren't, maybe we should pause again real quickly and take any additional questions. Otherwise, I'll jump into the digital learning model.
I don't think I have any questions come in, so go ahead.
All right. So first, we're going to talk about Khan Academy. And if you haven't heard about Khan Academy, it would be amazing not to hear about this, especially if you're a tutor. But you know, this has been around for 11 years now. It's used by 40 million students, 2 million teachers every month. I think most of us have seen what a Khan Academy is all about. You know, these are thousands of lessons, YouTube lessons, they're drawings on an electronic blackboard, very similar to the style of a teacher actually giving a lecture. And Khan also has other features like progress tracking, practice exercises, all kinds of teaching tools, and it's mobile friendly. So highly encourage you to get into Khan Academy. Go online. You have a free account. You can get in and actually jump in, and you know, look at it from the perspective of maybe one of your students, a second, third grader. Actually go through it. It's actually a lot of fun, and it will allow you to help them or give them a lot more help because you know what it's all about. Khan also supports and gives us back-end tools and reports that allow us to see the student progress. And I'll show you what that looks like in the next slide coming up. And as I mentioned earlier, School on Wheels provides a free Khan account for each of our students. So again, if they have access to a computer after school, can go to a library, anywhere, they can use their login and they can use Khan Academy after hours. And by the way, our reports will tell us whether they've been accessing it after school or not, which is really cool. So first we're going to talk about what a typical lesson looks like. So here's a basic multiplication lesson. This is an instructional video on YouTube. And this is just, again, basic multiplication. So it starts with an instructional video, then moves into exercises. So here you see some basic multiplication exercises, and they'll type in the answer right there. Whoops, didn't want to do that. They type in the answer, and then the lower right-hand corner where it says next question, that first says show result. And if they got it right, it will, in this case, they got it right. It'll show them that it's correct. If not, it'll tell them that it was incorrect and they have a opportunity to go back and correct it. Then they go to the next question and they finish that sequence. At the end of the lessons are quizzes. So here you see what a typical quiz looks like. And so there are three steps involved in this particular quiz question. And so the student has to choose where the mistake was made, or in this case, Hadley did not make a mistake. And so they would click that and they got this one right. And it says, there you go, that's the right answer, keep practicing. So Khan Academy is instructional video, exercise, quiz. And there are loads of these. Here is the math curriculum for a third grader. So on the left, you see the major topics of, there's four, and you see all the various lessons under each topic. So, you know, just some quick addition here, there's probably well over 200 lessons in the third grade math curriculum. And on the right-hand side, you'll see the various subtopics within those major topical areas. And so for our students, it will tell us and them how many they've completed. I mentioned we have access to analytics. Your TC will have access to these reports. So here's what a typical analytics report looks like. On the bottom, you'll see all the students listed. So what I did is I took a snapshot from our summer group at Washington Elementary, and the blanks indicate, even though they have accounts, those are the students that did not attend during the summer. So it's just showing the ones that were active. Now here's the really cool thing. You get to see how much time they've spent during normal school hours and outside of school hours. So I'm gonna look at right in the middle here, Anthony's account, and during this period, July 1st to August 31st, he had 200 active minutes on Khan Academy. And 6 different times that he logged in. And these are the various activity blocks that you see. And what I did was I moused over the top one, that's the last activity block for this period of time. And so it tells us that he spent 43 minutes during that particular activity. He watched 2 videos and he worked on 5 different skills. So he did a fabulous job here on that particular day in 43 minutes of work. So this is the kind of reports and analytics that we have access to as Khan Academy administrators. All right, so.
Sorry, Chris, I actually do have a question about Khan Academy.
Sure, fire away.
Yeah, so one tutor asked, how can we get the free Khan Academy account for our students? Do they already know their login info?
Okay, so at least in a group environment, what we do is we submit the names of the students and their grade level to School on Wheels. This all goes through your TC and your regional coordinator. And so there's someone at School on Wheels that's dedicated digital learning manager that's dedicated to actually creating the accounts and getting those back to the regional coordinators and then down to the tutor coordinators. So the answer is yes, you can do that. Just work with your regional coordinator on that. I think that's the right answer.
Yeah, that's good to know that that's how you go about it for the group tutoring. We can also I will send the commenter, there's a link where they can individually set up their student, but I think it's always good to kind of go through our digital learning team because they can help you with any questions that you have.
Sure.
And another question coming in.
Yeah.
I'm at a shelter where kids don't have access to the computer. So I think, yeah, I mean, I would say that can be a problem. The Khan Academy app can be used from your cell phone, but you have to download that and bring that in on your mobile device. You can't rely on the internet for that. I'm not sure if that will track the student progress in the same way. Chris, do you know?
That I don't know, but I can find out. And the other suggestion here might be, if the student has access, if they can go to a library, I'm sure School on Wheels would provide them with an account so that they could log in and take advantage of this.
Very good idea. Yeah. We can always, if the shelter is close enough to a library, maybe moving a tutoring session to the library could be something you could talk to the coordinator about. But definitely, always we can provide them with an account. And another question about Khan Academy, what are the quizzes to customize a lesson? Are there quizzes to customize a lesson?
Not that I know of. We've just been using the standard quizzes that go with each individual lesson.
Right.
I don't know that that you can actually customize a quiz though.
There is a quiz. Sorry, I'm just trying to look at what this tutor is seeing.
That's okay. These are great questions.
Yeah. Oh, she says when her student logs into Khan Academy, there's a quiz sitting on the right. Actually, our digital learning coordinator is Ian Chan, and he is typing in saying that yes, you can customize quizzes and curriculum
Oh.
on Khan Academy. I was not aware of that. I haven't used it really that much myself. So, is there maybe a way, Ian, I can connect you with this tutor afterwards, maybe, and.
Yeah, I'd like to learn how to do that also.
Yeah. So the tutor is Kelly. Kelly, I will have Ian connect with you after the webinar, and he will help you assist you with that. Great. Thank you.
All right.
Sorry, program administrator Ian Chan. There you go. Okay. All right, Chris, go ahead.
Very good. So thanks. Great questions, everybody. Okay, let's shift gears and talk about Teach Your Monster to Read, which it's a huge acronym. So it's easier to type that than the whole name. But again, if you haven't heard about this or you haven't seen it in action, it's a great program. It's a really fun phonics and reading game that's helped a lot of kids learn to read. And it's really for children in the first stages of learning or for some of our older students who need some more practice. So where I tutor at the elementary school, it's for everybody. And they love using this program. They ask to use this program as quickly as they can, which is really cool. And it covers everything from letters and sounds to reading full sentences. You can see who designed it, and it complements, typical phonics programs used in schools. And again, we provide a free account for each of our students. So, and it's the same login. They just use the same login information that they use for Khan. They use it for Teach Your Monster. So it's really easy for them to log in. So let's walk through what this looks like. So here's a typical Teacher Monster to Read lesson. The first thing that they do, which is always seems to be the most popular thing for them to do, they will spend a lot of time building their avatar. So they put a lot of thought into how do I want, you know, the arms, the legs, the face, the, you know, whether it has the horns or what kind of horns, or I mean, you can do a lot of different things, but they really put a lot of thought into building the avatar because it's the avatar that they're going to be using throughout the program. So that's really cool for them to do. And once they've got the avatar made, then they actually get into the fun exercises. And so here you see the avatar. The avatar has to collect all the sheep. And so it collects all the sheep, and they have to either put it into the S pen or the T pen. And hopefully they put all the sheep into the S pen. Once they get all the sheep in the S pen, then it goes to the next exercise. So again, this one is just the S versus T sound and putting various objects or identifying those objects and getting them in the right spot. And when they're done, when they've accomplished their lesson, this is really fun, they collect prizes. So there's a birthday cake here and some wings and some other stuff. So the reward for all of this is a really neat prize, and they collect prizes and go to different levels. And here you can see the apples in the background representing the S and the A sounds that they were working on in this particular lesson. So it's really fun. It does require headphones, just like Khan Academy. It requires headphones, and it's highly interactive, and the kids are really immersed in this, so it's really hard to get their attention when they're listening to this Teacher Monster to Read. So highly recommended for your students. There are some back-end analytics for this. I have not shown this. They're not as sexy as the Khan Academy analytics, but Ian does provide those. Ian Chan does provide those for us. And so as a tutor coordinator, those are available. So before I move forward, are there any questions on Teacher Monster to Read?
Yes, we have a question. Is it available for seventh graders? I think the answer is this app in particular is not.
It's really not designed for seventh graders. Although, you know, if a seventh grader is really far behind, then, you know, there may be some aspects of this that could serve as a refresher for them.
Got it. Yeah. The focus is on phonics for the Teacher Monster to Read. So it is recommended for K through second graders, Ian is saying. There are probably some apps out there that we can, again, Kelly, I will connect you with Ian after this. And I think there was a program he suggested to me recently. I forget the name of it, for an older student. But it is, yeah, it's definitely a good idea to use like an online service for an online service for your older students, because it is engaging and they do respond to it. So I will follow up with you after this.
Yeah, and in an elementary school environment, we do have a lot of students that are behind. And so they may be a fourth grader at a second grade reading level. So it's also very situational for us as well. Okay, so great. Thanks. Great question. So just to wrap up for group tutoring. So again, we need tutors. We always need tutors for group environments, especially during the day for the after-school programs. It's a lot harder to get tutors during the day than it is at night for obvious reasons. So if you're thinking about it, considering it, we'd love to have you. These environments require us to be flexible and creative, which for me, I love. I love the fact that we're building a program and we're kind of building it as we go along, and we have to be flexible, and it allows us to be very creative. For me, that's a really cool thing to do. I can color outside the lines. A TC, a tutor coordinator or lead tutor, is really essential to success in a group tutoring environment. So please consider helping out in that way if you can. It makes it a lot easier for all the other tutors. And we positively impact our students in so many ways. They need us. I can't tell you how great it is to walk in and see the welcome that we get when we're there, not only from the students, but from the parents and the teachers. They all appreciate what we do. So thank you for being a group tutor, or if you're considering this as an opportunity, thank you for considering it. And we hope you do follow through and at least try to do this at some point in your career with School on Wheels.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. There's another minute or so for questions.
Before we take those, I just want to point out, this is your, for resources, this is your first stop. Go to the School on Wheels volunteer page and then click on Tutoring Resources and Materials. This is where we get all our stuff. There's info on Common Core, what it's about, lessons. We're talking about different literacy websites for different grade levels. They're all there. Math websites, worksheets. And for the older kids, college planning and career exploration, educational games, tips, and much more stuff. So please, please make this your first stop. School on Wheels staff just has accumulated so many resources for us that we really want to take advantage of all this. And then on the last page, real quickly, here's some just other online resources that we found, or I found that we use, or maybe that the school uses. So with that, now we can take some last questions.
Okay, thank you again, Chris. Anybody wanna ask a question, feel free to type them in. This was super informative. I think it would be great for anybody considering group tutoring. You covered all the bases and we really went in depth in as to digital learning, which was great. So I think it was very informative. People are writing in thanks. I think we might be done for questions actually. So thank you again, Chris. And of course the question is about the copy of the PowerPoint slides. We will post this on our workshop library shortly after broadcast. So I will be emailing all attendees with the PowerPoint presentation. So you can look forward to that shortly within the next couple of days. So again, thank you everybody for attending. Thank you for being a tutor with us. We really appreciate it. And if you do have any questions after the broadcast about any of the stuff that you've seen here, please feel free to email me, Amanda Carr, acarr at School on Wheels, and we will follow up with you. So thank you, Chris, for sharing your experience, and have a great day, everybody.
Thanks. My pleasure. Thanks, everybody.